The hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
This morning, and welcome back to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, your station for fresh news, smart talk, all day. It's Wednesday, the 1st of December, 2021, and you are on the clock with Erin Greene. It's a bit of a somber morning, but I have to start with some good news. I want to say happy birthday to a number of people this morning, many of them colleagues, some of them fans, some of them I am a fan of, and some of them are family members, not by blood, but by commitment, So I want to say good morning to the one and only Dawn Sargent, guest co-host on Morning Blend and co-host of The Eye Opener on Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. I also want to say good morning and happy birthday to Howard Grant, former host at Guardian, colleague in the radio world. I know you out there looking sharp this morning, Mr. Grant. I want to say good morning to Alia Patrice, one of the members of our healthcare community that stay fighting the good fight for Bahamians. Happy birthday. So glad to see another solo return. To Ricky Roll, Estrada Roll, one of the greatest drummers in the history of the Bahamas, former member of Willis and the Illis. Good morning and happy birthday, Ricky Roll. And happy birthday to my colleague in the Caribbean, Fernanda Seely. Happy birthday out there. Drink some coconut water. Former. Now I have belated happy birthdays to Ms. Jill Wallace, mother of my guest yesterday, Alicia Wallace. And I just want to say, Miss Alicia Wallace, don't think I can get pinched for forgetting Jill's birthday by myself. Happy belated birthday, Jill. And happy belated birthday to Judith Thompson. Judith Thompson is a family member, family to the Greens, by commitment and not by blood. I want to send a special happy belated birthday to Judith Thompson. And it's just, there's just no words to sum it up, because I have another announcement that I have to make. And I want to announce the passing of my aunt, Nurse Juanita Greene. Aunt Juanita retired several years ago from Atlantis after 25 years of service there. She was the vice president with responsibility for health and safety at Atlantis. I played that song, All the Best Things, because I don't have any memories of it, but my auntie used to pick me up and put me in her Georgie bundle and take me to the States with her and her friends. And she showed me the world. And I could say all the best things in my life are because of you, as well as the other members of the Hasty and Greene family. Nurse Juanita Greene was the last surviving sibling of Una Hasty, my paternal grandmother. And she will be missed tremendously. I can't do her justice in these few moments at the opening of my show. I just can't. But I wanted to share the news so that we could all celebrate her passing into glory. We could all celebrate her new journey in another realm. And I want to say, if y'all are listening to my ancestors that have passed, I know y'all sitting under the dilly tree up there in heaven, and I know y'all annoying Peter, to Grammy Corinne Mitchell, to Helen Mitchell, to Lisa Powell Bailey, to Stephen Daddio Mitchell, to Bernard Greene, to Ozzie Greene, to Joan Butler, to Althea Knowles, to Una Hasty. Y'all make sure, fine, Aunt Juanita. Keep her with y'all under the big dilly tree. Because y'all are all the best things in my life. Anyway, thank you for sharing that moment with me. Arlington, play the rest of that song. Let's go to a break. And then I got an exciting show for you today. We're talking Success Summit, this year's 2021 Success Summit, Soursop and Other Ideas Hidden in Plain Sight, and Barbados Republic with Mr. Hubert Edwards after the break. Stay tuned to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. We'll be right back.
All the best things in my life have happened since I met you.
Security is a challenge for many. Now in a pandemic, many more are unsure of their next meal. Through their Feed 5000 program and a $20,000 donation, AML is working to ensure that everyone has a meal for the holidays, and they're inviting you to help. Now until December 17th, visit any Solomon's, Costrite, Fresh Market, or Domino's in Nassau or Freeport, and Exuma Markets in Georgetown to donate and help feed a family in need this Christmas. No amount is too small. Remember, we're all in this together.
Like what you're hearing on the show? Want to support the conversation? Sponsor On the Clock today. Call Janet Lees at 302-2304. That's 302-2304. Be the solution. Sponsor On the Clock of Erin Greene, where she dissects, we discuss, and you decide.
The new Guardian Radio app is here. Listen live to all our Guardian Radio shows and live video stream select programs in our studio. Get information about Guardian Radio shows and our hosts. Send messages, including text, email, and even call. All from our amazing new Guardian Radio app. Download it free today in your App Store for your Apple device or Play Store for your Android device. The all-new and improved Guardian Radio app.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
All the love I've given you. Doesn't have repay the warmth and tenderness you gave. And the greatest thing, I've learned to trust you, and now I can see that all the best things in our lives will come from you and me. Since the moment when I met you, my life's revolved around only you.
Good morning and welcome back to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, your station for fresh news, smart talk all day. You're on the clock with Erin Greene, and this morning we're talking about the Success Summit 2021 with Mr. Hubert Edwards. Good morning, Mr. Edwards. How are you?
Good morning, Erin. It's certainly a pleasure. Looking forward to having this conversation with you for the longest time. But certainly this is a good time to have it.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm totally excited about Success Summit. I haven't been yet, but I have a great opportunity to come this year because I can connect online, definitely, without having to travel, without having to go anywhere. And, I have a big job this week. I have to go guard my soursop tree. So I can't, once I finish with the station, I get go back home and guard my soursop tree. I don't think this is traditionally soursop season. Most people don't get soursop on their tree this time, but we've had an unexpected amount of rain for the year and this in the season.
Well, you know, if you can do that, and if you can come do one of those chick chana dance around my soursop tree so that it would bear, I would really, really appreciate that. I've had it for a while, and it's not doing what it's supposed to be doing. I'm not sure why, but, soursop is such a wonderful fruit. It's something which, I remember growing in Jamaica. We used to go into the bushes, and we used to hunt for them, and we used to go on to the farms with the cows. They used to have, thousands and thousands of cows. And we literally used to risk our lives to go look for soursop.
Now, okay, so, wow, were the soursop trees in the cow pastures? Like, do you think that there were thousands? Because here's...
What would happen is that you would have these, acres and acres of pasture lands, but where there were fruit trees, the fruit trees were kept. They didn't take them out. So there was a lot of soursop. There were oranges. There was custard apple, mangoes, guineps, and so on.
Right.
We were all forbidden from going there. But we always do. We do that. There was also some ponds which the cows would drink from.
Okay.
And we would go there and catch fish from it too. So, everything that we on those lands were forbidden. But, as young men, some young women too, we had a whale of a time. We were like hunter-gatherers. We just found everything that we could, and we just partake of it.
Listen, if I was looking for money or treasure, I send in little children to find it. And I ain't giving them no breakfast. If they hungry, they gonna find it, right?
Definitely.
and look at that idea. Why I was fascinated when you said that is, so I have a soursop tree in my yard, and I'm always, it doesn't produce, it doesn't bear as prolifically as much as I think it should bear, right? So I'm always observing it, trying to see if I could get a sense of why it's not bearing without actually doing any scientific research, right? I want to observe. And so I notice a couple of things. I noticed that soursop like to hide, right? Like they don't want to be seen. And when you look at a soursop tree, you may not notice all of the fruit that's on it because the fruit doesn't want to necessarily be out in the sun. It wants to be sort of hidden behind the leaves a little bit, right? I found that fascinating. So I wondered if my tree wasn't bushy enough, like it wasn't big enough to give the fruit the type of coverage that it wanted to stay on the tree. Now that may seem odd, that like idea may seem odd to people who are not used to farming, but if you know about pumpkin and things that grow on a vine, then you know that they are shy. And if you look at your pumpkin vine too much, it ain't gonna bear fruit. And right, and they wanna run, pumpkin wanna run hidden, low coverage, like sort of in the bush a little bit. And so when I remembered that, I said, yeah, you know what? This soursop like to hide.
I don't think the soursop is hiding, Erin. I think the fact is that the fruit itself is pretty much the same color as the leaves. In the healthy leaves, they're nice and shiny. The fruit is about the same complexion or coloring. Compare that to, say, some other type of fruits which have a different coloration from the leaves themselves, right, and kind of stand out. Mm-hmm. That's why you miss them oftentimes. And sometimes you only realize you have a soursop when you smell it, when the birds have already started to partake.
Right. Now, see, listen, what that tells me is that mango is a show off, right? See, all mango is a little color and plenty sweet, you know.
Yeah.
But watch this. The best mangoes are the hairy mangoes because they give you the fiber necessary to contribute to great gastro and intestinal health, right? Because the fiber in the fruit is good for bowel movements and helping your body to pass.
Mm-hmm.
The hairy mangoes don't take color. The hairy mangoes don't get red and yellow. The mangoes with most value hide themselves by maintaining the color of the leaves. But the pretty mangoes know all they have is color and sugar, and they have to sell themselves somehow. So they get pretty on the outside, right? And these are the things that fascinate me about fruit. And I wonder if other Bahamians, when they go outside and they see a fruit tree, if they see all of the ideas that I see that are hidden in plain sight, right? to the point where even my gardener didn't know how many soursop were on the tree this season, right? And he tend the tree every week. Even he didn't realize just how many fruit were tucked up in the tree. And I wonder if Bahamians, if we have lost our connection to the land and our traditional practices, right? I wouldn't even call them farming practices because you weren't a farmer. You were a person that ate fruit. Like, that's your thing. I like fruit. I go in the bush to go look for fruit. As a part of your practice, you know, the things that you observed are valuable and help you to build skills that you could use, not just for your development into an adult, but in the what we call the real, real world.
Yeah. I remember back in those days, we were just being, adventurous and in some instance disobedient because we were told not to go. So we had to go see what exactly is there to be seen. But those adventures, some of them were dangerous. I can remember one time going to the pasture land and there was this custard apple tree.
Uh-huh.
And this custard apple tree decided that its direction of growth must be right over the pond itself. So the bulk of the tree is over the pond.
Uh-huh.
And the best custard apples are over water.
Uh-huh.
And I remember us going on that tree and climbing out all the way to the end and picking those custard apples. And, you know, years later, I was reflecting on it and I realized, but guess what? I couldn't swim at those times. And if I had fallen into the pond, you know, that would be all she wrote. So, you know, it was dangerous, but, you know, was very excited. And as I listened to you talk on your shows, and you talk about the chikani, and you talk about going into the bush, I kind of remember and reminisce of those moments, right? I'm not going to tell anybody they were all great, because when you walk through a pasture land as a 3 foot plus or 4 foot young child, you will come out with a lot of ticks and that sort of thing, right? Yeah. There were huge downside and huge risk that we took, but there were great excitement. And there are moments that I reflect on now and remember with some sort of a nostalgia. But back then, may have been a little bit too much. And that's why our parents were upset with us. Yeah.
Well, absolutely. And I'm sure the idea that you'd be accused of being a thief when really you're just going to collect some fruit that'll probably go to waste anyway, right?
Because if Busha had catch us, that's the man who oversee the farm now, right?
Right.
He would shoot at us.
Yeah.
So we did that at our risk. Usually, I understand that he didn't use real bullets, but he would shoot at us.
Yeah.
But we took the risk anyway. So, yeah, we would
want to find out if he does real bullets.
And I imagine that not only was it worth the risk, the nutritional value. See, I'm a Mitchell and a Hasty. On my Mitchell side, they used to have a hog plum tree in the yard. And every hog plum season, as my family members are eating hog plum, I have to listen to them talk about when they was growing up. They go out in the yard and they eat hog plum all day and they didn't have to eat no food for the rest of the day. And you know, I sit back jealous listening to those stories, not just because I love fruit, because I think of the impact that has had on their physical health. At those formative stages, that their experience, particularly in the summer, was sort of being released and going off into the wild, into the bush, and foraging for fruit. And while we in the 21st century may think that's what people do,
Erin, the truth is, some of those stories are embellished, right? If I sit here and tell you how much of a great hunter and adventure and I was going in there to do this, that's not true.
Listen,
we were just looking for food. In many instances, we were hungry and we went out maybe a little bit adventurous and we spent long days out on these places and, you know, we didn't carry food. And so at some point in time, you get hungry, you get thirsty, and you start to look around and figure, you know, where am I going to get food? And, you know, if a soursop turned up, great. If a custard apple turned up, great. We found oranges. If it was mango time, we did the mangoes. So, you know, it was just playing it by ear. But at the end of the day, yes, it was enjoyable.
See, because I think you're trying to tell me that my daddy lied to me when he tell me he used to walk 3 miles to school in the morning. And God forbid if it was snowing, he had to put on 2 pairs of shoes. You trying to tell me he was lying?
No, a little bit embellished. I used to walk to school. My initial walk to school was really maybe about 2+ miles, and then later on it would be just about under a mile back and
Yeah.
1 mile one way, 1 mile back. But I know of students who were in my class at various schools who used to walk +5 miles to school every single day back and forth. So, you know, it's easy to recognize that.
Yeah, absolutely. But you see, the thing about the soursop now is when I'm sitting down thinking about Success Summit, I thought, look, the soursop is all of these ideas, right, hidden in plain sight. Bahamians can't see. Success Summit is the place where you go to show people the value and the economic benefit of a thing like soursop. And, you know, this thing is sitting right in front of us, hidden in plain sight. And I wonder if Bahamians see it, right? Soursop is high in vitamin C, right? That vitamin C system, improving its ability to defend against pathogens. It promotes the destruction of free radicals. which can help to protect your skin and cells from environmental and oxidative damage.
Lots of antioxidants is in there too.
Right. The soursop leaves are mildly sedative and can be used to treat or reduce anxiety and nervousness, promote relaxation and induce sleep, or treat insomnia. The bark, the root, the leaf, the fruit have various medical applications. And the crushed seeds are used mainly against internal and external parasites, like worms and lice. And while we were talking online, you reminded me that, you know, plenty of people like soursop in cream, like coconut milk, sweet milk with spices, yeah. Right?
Yeah, sweet milk. You take the coconut. You take the soursop. And you put it in a cup or in a container. You put the milk directly on it. If it's cold, then that's all the better. Start to go. When there was no milk, then sugar will work. You know, so it's really the same. It's about culinary delight. You have the tartness and the tang of the soursop and the sweetness of the sugar or the milk, and it totally works. And soursop is just a nice thing.
I mean,
my colleague Steve Ward is also on the call. He is actually in Jamaica, and so, you know, he can support some of these things. I think he had an opportunity to do one or two of them as a young man.
Good morning, Mr. Ward. How are you?
I am awesome. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm sorry I didn't know you were on the call. I would have started a war immediately between the Bahamas and Jamaica on who has produced the best soursop, if I knew you were here. But I'll tell you why, right? Because I think the rich soil in Jamaican farmlands certainly are perfect for growing soursop and produce large, huge fruit, right? And we see great production. But I have a feeling that the limestone rock content, you know, in Bahamian farmlands adds a different attribute to the soursop and give it a different flavor profile that may make our soursop superior to the Jamaican soursop. But that's just an idea. That's just an idea.
And I will be speaking from a biased perspective because I've never had a Bahamian soursop. So the Jamaican soursop will always be the best for me. I will take reference from Bertie's recommendation. You know, he has had both.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, I can give him a buy. The last time I went to Jamaica, I ate like 1,000 mangoes, so I don't upset nobody from Jamaica. But I just thought with the movement yesterday, the momentous changing of the guard in Barbados, right?
Uh-huh.
I was thinking about all of the ways that the Bahamas and other countries in the region could work together to bring some of our ideas to success. I was thinking about this idea, the soursop, and other fruit as well. But I'll tell you, the idea was inspired by my aunt, who I mentioned this morning, because years ago, when I was a little child, my father bought a cherry tree. And the cherry tree is, I think, a Bayesian cherry. But the cherry tree, when you shake it and the little pieces of flower fall off, they cause you to itch.
Mm-hmm.
But my Aunt Juanita loved these cherries so much that she didn't care about the itching. When she came to her cherry tree, she would tell us, just get the alcohol ready. Right? And I thought the love of fruit could drive us to endure some things. But imagine when we commit ourselves to an idea in that way, where we can take ourselves. And so, I was trying to bring those sort of ideas together to begin this discussion on this year's Success Summit under the theme, Transform You, Transform Your World. So let's begin. Tell us about this year's theme and why Success Summit. Why is this conference so important?
Yeah, well, that's where the theme started out, Erin, and mm-hmm. we have kind of morphed it to success keys to transform your world. So we want persons to have a clear idea that when they come to the summit, we are going to be delivering things. But it goes back to what you just said fundamentally. When you set out on anything that you do in life, if you want to be good at it, if you want to be successful, you first have to transform yourself. You know, you cannot sustain success. You cannot sustain anything unless you yourself has first become. And that is what we want persons to kind of reflect on, that this is not about you trying to be the, you know, all in all, and you trying to change the whole world. But when you change yourself, when you grow and you develop, when you add value to yourself, then all opportunity to do great things. Erin Greene didn't just wake up one morning and, you know, start to do radio and do it well. You know, you were a guest who impressed some people, and they kept calling you back. You spent some time, you poured into yourself, and you drew on the knowledge and the information and the eras of passion of agriculture and so on. And you bring all of that into be able to tell a story. That's what we want a person to understand. When you bring the true you and the full you to whatsoever it is that you do, you know, success is likely to follow. And so this is kind of the essence and the foundation on which we're building. We have built this year's summit, and really which we have built it for the last 5 years.
Absolutely. And so the theme for this year's conference is Success, Keys to Transform Your World. Tell me, who are some of the presenters and moderators at this year's event, and how do you select them? Like, I got a couple of people I may want to nominate for next year's event.
Yeah, well, you know, we are always open to persons. Basically, the way these things work, you kind of your network, and you reach out to persons who are sometimes willing and able. Mm-hmm. In some instances, some persons just really can't make it. But we, for the most part, we look for individuals who are committed to the growth and development of others, persons who are given, persons who are willing to take the time to prepare and deliver at a very high level. And so in that regard, you will see on this year, for the first day, for example, Steve, who is on the call, is going to be here. Another colleague, Garfield Morgan, out of Jamaica, is going to be there. We have Cheryl Carroll, Pastor Burrows. We have Carlos Palacios, Heather Sutherland, Young Bohemian, Nikira Dean, and a young man out of Nigeria, Jesse Kanada. And so we look for diversity. We look for diversity of idea, diversity of backgrounds, and we believe that every individual has something to bring and something to give that they will, you know, help to add additional flavor, and importantly, to knowledge from their own perspective, their own stories, which will impact with different persons. So that's kind of how we choose it. On day two, there's also a guy out of a gentleman out of Canada, connected with Africa, Alex Ayama, Jeffrey Beckers. We have Franklin Butler. Mm-hmm. We have the president-elect of Toastmasters International. He's going to be the president for the entire world of Toastmasters next year, Mr. Matt Kinsey. We have Simone Bow. We have Troy Strawn. We have a quantum psychologist coming out of Jamaica, Lakem Samaj, and a number of other individuals, Ahmad Thompson, you know, it goes on and on. And so we select these persons largely because they are willing to spend the time and to give back. Anastasia Palacios, persons know most of these individuals.
Wow. I mean, that is fascinating. Quantum psychologist, I want to know, is he going to tell me how I feel in the future, in the far future? Oh, boy. Well, listen, I got to go to a break. When we come back from the break, let's talk about the 2021 Excellence Awardees and Scholarship winners, because this looks like a wonderful list of people. So please stay tuned to Guardian 96.9 FM. We'll be right back after this break with Hubert Edwards and the Success Summit Conference. Stay tuned.
Security is a
challenge for many. Now in a pandemic, many more are unsure of their next meal. Through their Feed 5000 program and a $20,000 donation, AML is working to ensure that everyone has a meal for the holidays, and they're inviting you to help. Now until December 17th, visit any Solomon's, Costrite, Fresh Market, or Domino's in Nassau or Freeport, and Exuma Markets in Georgetown to donate and help feed a family in need this Christmas. No amount is too small. Remember, we're all in this together.
Physical distancing is an important prevention in the fight against COVID-19. Respiratory droplets travel from one person to another through sneezing, coughing, laughing, or simply talking. The risk of becoming infected from those droplets is reduced by staying 6 feet away from other persons at all times. Even shaking hands and touching our face is not recommended because we frequently touch surfaces that may be contaminated. Practice physical distancing at the workplace by having virtual meetings or conference calls, or communicate via email. Eat at your desk instead of in the cafeteria. You can even work from home. We must each do our part to stop the spread of COVID-19.
This message brought to you by Bahamas Ministry of Health in conjunction with Guardian Radio.
Good morning and welcome back to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You are on the clock with Erin Greene on this Wednesday, the first. No, we're at the end of the show. If you want to text in any questions about Success Summit or brief comment, you can text us at 422-GR96. That's 422-4796. Or you can call us at 323-6232, 325-4316, or 325-4259. Good morning, Mr. Edwards and Mr. Ward. Welcome back.
Thank you for having us back.
Absolutely.
Yes,
so the 2021 Leadership Excellence Awards and Scholarship winners.
Before we talk about that, Erin, I just want to, Steve is our Conroy Ward, the persons who grew up with him running through the bush know him as Steve. And I was one of those persons. So I just wanted to for him to, you know, kind of, you know, say, you know, why he is connected with the Success Summit and what he intends to bring.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Come Friday, because he's going to be speaking on the first day, which is Youth Day. So we just want to.
Absolutely.
Well, Success Summit is something that I have been associated with for the past 5 years. I remember when Bert came out and we were doing rounds in Jamaica at the schools. I mean, that was a phenomenal experience. Now, being asked to become a presenter is something that I really believe is an honor. And that come tomorrow or come Friday when we present, we're going to make sure that we give them our experience, where we're coming from, what we believe are the keys to becoming successful. Most successful people have these attributes. Most successful people follow these characteristics or have these characteristics. But when we look at it, some people have that goal in their sight but just can't reach it. Mm-hmm. What we're going to do, we're going to give them our experiences, show them how they can tap into it. Success is different things to different people. Mm-hmm. We had a very bad dog in our area once, and there was a little boy who refused to pass the dog. He would just run past. But as Bertie said, that you have to change inside, change your entire being. Fear was really crippling that boy. And then one day we stood there and watched him. He purposed in himself, look, I'm gonna pass that dog today. Mm-hmm. And he muscled up and ran as fast as he could, ran past the dog. The dog didn't even see him, how he was running past. Mm-hmm. To him, that was success. He changed his entire being to get that done.
Right.
And that is what we want to get out of people. How do you change? Mm-hmm.
And that's fascinating, right? That small, what is perceived as a small action by others created a massive change. His whole life and outlook on the world and location in it. That is fabulous. Because I was about to ask, it's great, the first day is Youth Day. I was about to ask for youth or young leaders. And will we see you that know, next year?
Yeah, you know, I listened to that with fascination as we were preparing. And definitely it's, you know, every year we try to add something to the menu to kind of extend the flavor, and it's an era that we will definitely look into. We had the opportunity this year to partner with Pastor Dave Burrows and his iRise organization to put on Youth Day, and so we welcome that. Obviously, going forward, we will sit back and look and see how it went and determine how we can improve that. And, you know, so we're always going to be improving, and we're always open to ideas. And one of the things that we want to see next year, Erin, is when we put the nominations out for persons to be nominated, we want individuals to come forward and nominate. We are not selecting persons. We are keeping this at a very high level, and we are going to be very, very true to our standards. So if persons do not qualify, we're not going just because we want to make up the numbers, but it is for you, the individuals out there, to, you know, capitalize on this, to identify individuals in your community, in the country, who should be recognized, nominate them, and we will certainly review. And if they qualify, you know, we definitely will have them as an awardee.
Absolutely. So tell us about the Dr. Miles Monroe Memorial Award and the Marcus Garvey Dr. Robert Love Memorial Award.
Yeah, well, you know, Dr. Miles Monroe is a very special individual, certainly to the Bahamas and to the world, and a real inspiration to me. And so when we had the opportunity through ITWALA, International Third World Leaders Association, which he founded and which is now under the chairmanship of his son, Chairo, and they gave us approval to use his name, you know, it was a delight. So we have four individuals who we will be recognizing this year. In the past, we did three. We wanted to do five. We didn't get to five. So we have Tanya McCartney, Evelyn Kassar, Keith Major, and Dr. Burrows himself, who we will be recognizing. The Dr. Joseph Robert Love and Marcus Garvey, there's a connection there. Mm-hmm. Robert Love was born right here in the Bahamas. He went to the United States. He became a doctor. He spent some in Haiti, and he eventually ended up in Jamaica, where he was a part of the legislature. He actually died in Jamaica and is buried in that halfway tree era. And so we wanted to bring those two. He then became, he was one of the mentors. He inspired Marcus Garvey. Mm-hmm. So Robert Love was really one of our foremost Pan-Africanists from the region. And so I wanted to bring that Bahamas and Jamaica thing together, right? And so we are using this to recognize individuals who are not native Bahamians. They were born outside of the Bahamas, and they would have come to the Bahamas and contributed significantly in whatsoever way they choose to do so to the country. And this year we are recognizing Patrick Anlan and Clement Foster. Patrick Anlan from Jamaica. Clement Foster is originally from Trinidad and Tobago.
Okay.
So we wanted to use this platform, Success Summit Hubert Edwards Global, as a way of uplifting, as a way of recognizing, and importantly, as a way of giving back to the community. And we're doing this largely through our scholarships. We have five scholarship awardees. All have been selected, one from Freeport, four from New Providence, and that's just based on their qualification. We had over 30 applications this year, which was encouraging. And so we will be there, and we'll be providing them with scholarship grants. These scholarship grants will be given in the name of Dr. Richard Binder, Michelle Miller, L. Sidney Song, my friend Paula Prosper, who is an Asian American, and my young friend and neighbor, Sotaria Ferreira, who passed last year, the son of Ramal Ferreira, and we just remembering him as a young student who kind of just left us too soon. We're using this platform to remember individuals who have contributed and who have inspired us on the journey. So that's basically what we're doing, and we encouraging persons to come out and be a part of this. It is totally free. It's virtual. Or if you want to turn up at BFM, we'll have accommodation for you there. To register, you just need to go on nlsolutionsbahamas.com, nlsolutionsbahamas.com, and you will find a link and you can register.
Right. So like maybe if I have bad Wi-Fi or data in my area or at home, I could come to the church and in a with social distancing, you'll find a space for me, or you have a space set up for people to participate. Yes. There. That's awesome.
We'll be in the main sanctuary.
Okay.
And it is significant. You can sit as far as 30 feet away from anybody, from the nearest person. So, you know, come out and participate. I think this is an important movement. We're not just doing this for ourselves. We're doing this to really impact not just the Bahamas, but Jamaica and the wider Caribbean. You know, as Steve will readily tell you, this is something we have been working on a long time.
Man, listen, and there's so many letters I have to go. I have to go to the post office right now and grab that letter. I wrote a letter about the war between Jamaica and the Bahamas and Soursop. I'm going to rescind that letter, and I'm going to write a new letter. The first letter is to Mia Motley and the new president of Barbados, and I'm going to tell them, listen, we need to borrow a few things, including Your Excellency Riri Fenty. We have to borrow her. And then I must write Jamaica again. I've been petitioning. We need a treaty on mangoes. Jamaica have 7 million mangoes all the time, and we only have 12. But I have this idea that I want to grow to a successful, sustainable point where we have a regional food forest that stretches across the ocean and across waters, where citizens in different jurisdictions could rely on the good graces of their brothers and sisters to send them some fruit when necessary. And I think that this will be the most successful regional movement in modern history of the Bahamas.
You know, Erin, as you say it in that way, but the truth is that our food security, the food security of the Bahamas, Jamaica, and all of the other countries is going to be highly dependent on regional cooperation. If we can come together, we can secure this region. We have enough people and we have enough land and we have enough wherewithal to become way safer from a food perspective. And it's something that should be pursued in a serious way.
And I love the global perspective of the conference, and I'm excited about seeing more jurisdictions or more participants become a part of the discussion. There's nothing more important than regional unity, except for honoring our ancestors, right? Which we also need to do in a regional way. But gentlemen, I have a call on the line. Let's try and get them in before the end of the show. One moment here. Good morning, caller. You're on the clock.
I got the day to the stock in the voice.
Good morning, Bremen. How are you?
Pretty high, Erin Green.
Good morning.
We need justice, law, and order in this country. Erin, don't you think, according to your observation, whether borrowing fruits or sending fruits and vegetables, I suppose,
regionally,
to the Bahamas from other country, right now, we're not producing anything. Don't you think you are encouraging people to be lazy and beggars when it comes to the Bahamian?
No. Okay, thank you, Bremen. I'm going to cut you there. You almost run by encouraging. First of all, there's nothing bad about encouraging people to grow and eat fruit. But more importantly, no. It's a beauty in the regional model. There is a strategy in it. I can't even find the right word, Bremen. You throw me off there. But this, I'm glad you said it, because the best strategy is for us to work together throughout the region to produce what we need and can't necessarily produce ourselves, right? And so Jamaica's been producing rice. I think Trinidad may even be producing rice. We don't have to get rid of rice in our diet because we can't grow it ourselves. We need to be working with our regional partners to ensure that when we are eating rice, we are also supporting the regional and local economy and not diminishing it. So I rebuke that idea, Bremen. We couldn't be making people lazy with that kind of thinking. No, man, but I appreciate the interrogation. Now, on the second point. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If you put up anything in terms of food, even on the social media page, the number of responses you get from persons that are not in the country is phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
It is you that are used to, that is when you're most appreciative of it.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can find the numbers of persons of Bahamians living outside of Bahamas, the number of Jamaicans living outside of Jamaica, and then you put up a soursop and you will hear and see how they are responding to that soursop, how they are responding to mangoes. If you should have a mango festival, a soursop festival at some point in time, encourage them to come back. That can create some level of employment. It can also create some level of investment,
mm-hmm,
in looking at how we can change soursop into other things so that people can really appreciate it.
Absolutely.
We need to get the current generation all hyped about these things too. They're not.
Absolutely. I mean, and hype right up. Gentlemen, we all out of time, and Brayman gone and excite me. Boy, look here, sometimes the mischievous ones has come and do that to you, and that's why we appreciate them. Down and enjoying this conversation, because if anybody did love a hairy mango, my Aunt Juanita did love a hairy mango, and they're soon becoming a luxury item because Bahamians, some who don't understand them and scorn them, are just throwing them away out their yard. And soon the hairy mango will be the most valuable mango in the Bahamian market. Mr. Ward and Mr. Edwards, I want to thank you so much. Just as we go, tell the people, remind them of the dates of the conference and how they can sign up and participate.
The dates are Friday and Saturday. That's the 3rd and the 4th. You can go on nlsolutionsbahamas.com and you will find a link to sign up for the Zoom. You can also see it via Facebook or via YouTube. And you can also check out social media. I have a lot of posts in there. And certainly, we're looking forward to you coming out and support us. This is our 5th year. We're celebrating leadership and we're celebrating education. We need your support. We need you in the room so that the presenters, the success advocates, can feel that they have a tangible numbers to present to. And we look forward to next year when we do number 6.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I know it's going to be a success. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you to my audience for tuning in. I am all out of time. My producer cutting his eye at me. I owe him a soursop now. It's not his fault. We got to go. Thank you for staying tuned to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Remember to tune in to Success Summit presented by Hubert Edwards Global. Have a wonderful day, Bahamas.
A lovely day when you came into my life. The timing was right. There's one thing I want you, the best of my love. Hey, you get the best of my love.